My name is Justin Render, product specialist here at Kinsey Manufacturing. We're in a farm down at my place. As you can see, we've had cattle out here over winter. This winter actually was very odd. Where we normally go into a deep freeze and stuff stays frozen, we like to rotate our cows out onto the crop ground. We feed them out here. This winter was a little bit different. Started off really cold and then kind of stayed in that halfway frozen range. As you can tell, it's been pugged up really bad. There's lots of tracks out here. So today we want to highlight a couple different things that the mock-till can do. The first one here is making a rescue pass on heavily top compacted, and we're going to do some soil hits. But that top inch and a half where the cows have been walking around or where the tracks have ran is really above that 300 PSI range. Then once you bust through that, we drop well down in almost that 100 range, just a tad over 100, and a lot of samples that we've taken. So making that rescue pass, also leveling that ground up before we plant. Spring has sprung here in Iowa and soils are starting to warm up, getting dried out enough, so it's time to go fix some of the sins that we've had from this winter. The next thing we're going to do this afternoon is go over some, I'm going to say, reclamation ground. We did some tiling and bulldozing over at another farm. I want to show you guys what it can do to prepare that ground as well for that spring planter pass. Mock-till is one of the tools that a lot of customers don't necessarily think of it being a spring soil finishing machine. Take it versus a blade machine versus a sweep machine. A lot of guys have problems running those in the springtime or think they don't work very well. Well, today we kind of want to show you the proofs in the pudding, so to speak. So whether it's on our farm or a customer's farm, really want to highlight that spring side of what this machine can do and maybe give you guys some ideas as well. So right now we're just getting, like I said, getting everything set, trying to make sure it's doing what it needs to do. We're going in and really just working the area that we're starting in where we took that compaction hit, for example, and seeing what the difference is afterwards. So we saw, you know, it was well up over 300 PSI to get broke through that, you know, an inch and a half worth of crust. After that, we very quickly come back down in that, you know, 100, 125 range, which is great for root growth, but really just trying to set the stage so when we run the planter out here that, hey, we've got a good seed bed, we've got this residue worked in, we've got the manure worked in, our pug tracks. If you could imagine all these different pug tracks, think of your gauge wheel on your planter. It's gonna be sitting there bouncing, trying to make up for that. So your depth's gonna be affected, your actual germination at that point, I think, would be affected as well. So we're just trying to fix some of those sins. With our furrow roller, we're setting that density equal, so when we run the planter through there, it's equal density chain. We don't have air pockets or gaps or a bunch of fluffed up stuff that you have air voids or pockets for that seed to fall in, and therefore when it germinates, it doesn't have moisture around it, it dies. So it's no longer a viable plant. So trying to keep more of that money in our producer's pocket as well as my own this year. So the other thing we're gonna do this afternoon is go over to a farm where we did some dirt work this fall. We did some tiling, as well as we had a couple spots we pushed some trees out, and those bulldozer tracks ran at the same time where these cattle were here. Very similar type of situation where it was all, I'm gonna say, mucky on top and caused a lot of surface compaction, as well as it's never been tilled before and leveled out. So we're gonna go over there and get it ready for planting. Running over these tile lines, yeah, we're making one pass over them with the blades not even in the ground. We're just actually using that, the tires of the tractor and the roller to help. And then from that point, going over top of them again to help distribute that soil. And then on all these terraces and side hill where this ground's been bulldozed, it's very bumpy and rough from the tracks and compacted on top. Breaking through that crust, leveling everything out, getting to where we're underneath that, you know, the PSI range for root growth and setting that stage for excellent planter season. And swung it around and parked, so we kind of had the same area we were taking compaction hits before, just to see the before and after. So you'll notice we still have some residue that isn't quite completely buried because we were slowing down going in, but overall you can walk across this a whole lot easier than tripping. So we'll just take a hit here. Barely over 150 at the same depth, actually probably a little bit deeper. So that extreme, you know, trying to force it through at 300, we've changed that down to about 150. Let's take another one. That guy's barely 120, so a lot different, and it gets softer as we go down. We start hitting moisture, but we've taken care of that heavily compacted area. So now, instead of this being a bumpy mess, trying to run a bean header flat to the ground, now we've got something that's a lot more level. Your soil stability is a lot more equal for planting. So we can not only get more with our planter, we can harvest more with the combine. Kind of threefold, we've got a better soil conditions to plant into, better germination, and then also better harvestability performance. So being able to keep that header lower and capture more of those lower pods that typically get ran over. So kind of a threefold thing to put back in your pocket at the end of the day.